We're going to do a brief introduction to snakes today. Snakes are elongated, legless reptiles of the suborder Serpentis. This is the easiest way to and the shortest way to identify snakes. They can be distinguished because of the absence of eyelids and external ears. Their main feature is that they are ectothermic. They depend on the external environment to maintain their basic temperatures, and they are covered with overlapping scales. There is very little fossil history that is available about the snake, simply because of the way their bones are structured. They have a very delicate skeleton, and therefore fossil history about them was very minimally available. One of the earliest snakes to appear on the fossil records was found in the Saharan Desert in the early Cretaceous period, about 130 million years ago. Let's look at the senses that they use. We have five senses that we use to function effectively in our daily lives. With snakes, let's start with sight. Their sight is not very good. Their hearing is poor because they have no external ears, but they have a very good sense of picking up vibrations of the ground using their lower jaw. If you look at the anatomy of the snake, imagine everything put into a tubular structure. They do have the same organs as we do. So they have two lungs. One of them is rudimentary though. They have a liver, a stomach, an esophagus, about 40 to 100 vertebrae, depending on the number of species. These vertebrae are covered with muscles that allow them to move, and they have teeth, the brain, eyes, everything that we have, except that it is arranged differently in a tubular fashion. When we think of snakes moving, we generally have just one movement in mind, but they have four different kinds of movement. We start with concertina, where it is actually the music organ, and the second one is the lateral undulation movement, which is the most common one that we see with snakes. The third one though is the sidewinding movement. This is mainly used in species that live in dry, arid areas. Because of the heat that is on the ground, they use this motion and it helps them navigate heat patches, because only two parts of the body touches the ground when they are moving. The last one is the caterpillar-like movement, which is called rectilinear movement, and it is seen in a very few snakes in our country. Look at how the snake is able to sense its environment. It mainly does this with picking up chemical signals, that is using the forked tongue. So the forked tongue, when it comes out, it picks up chemical signals from the environment, and then it is pushed back into their upper palate, where they have a Jacobson's organ. This Jacobson's organ is connected to the brain, and it picks up the chemical signals and translates it to the brain, that allows the snake to identify with its environment. So basically, assessing the environment is based on a chemical signal that the snake uses. Some snakes have very distinct pits. They are thermal sensing pits that they have just below the eyes, in front, between the eyes and the nostrils. They pick up heat signatures that could be from a predator, that could be from a prey, and it tells them, it allows them to identify the heat signature even in complete darkness. When we talk about feeding in snakes, there are two mainly distinctive patterns that we understand. Venomous snakes use venom that is injected into their prey, and they kill them and eat them. The non-venomous snakes would either use ambush hunting or stealth hunting, or they would even crush their prey by constricting around them and actually suffocating them before they feed. But they always eat them whole. There is no chewing. They swallow their prey whole. Venomous snakes have venom fangs. They have a venom gland. The fangs that deliver the venom into the prey, they're actually like hypodermic needles. So they're hollow, and they have an ability to pass the venom directly into their prey. The fang is connected by a venom duct to the venom gland, and behind this is a compressor muscle. The compressor muscle actually regulates the amount of venom that is squeezed out of the venom gland through the fang into the prey. Venom is sort of a cocktail of proteins, toxins, and digestive enzymes that helps the venomous snake start the digestion of the prey as soon as the venom is injected. They generally swallow whole. There are some very specialized feeders. One of the most popular one of the most well-known of these is the king cobra, Ophiophagus hanna. And from the name itself, we can identify Ophiophagus means it's a snake eater. So the primary diet that we know of this snake is other snakes. But in the wild, there have been records that these snakes have also eaten monitor lizards and sometimes even scavenged on them. 25% of the snakes in India are viviparous, that is, they have babies directly. There are no eggs that are laid, and the other part are all egg layers. They have almost leathery eggs that are laid in specific environments, sometimes from dry arid areas to very high humidity areas as well. The king cobra is the only snake possibly in the world that actually builds a nest for egg laying, and it's an engineering miracle actually, the way the nest is constructed by a limbless reptile. So they gather the leaf litter which is on the ground and construct a large nest, and the eggs are laid in the middle of this particular nest. The other interesting fact is that pythons, when they lay their eggs, they actually encircle the eggs and constrict their muscles repeatedly and produce heat, which helps incubate the eggs. This process is known as brooding. For courtship and mating, the males follow each other, and they have something called as a combat dance in some species. And it's a very gentlemanly exercise where they only use force to press the other snake's head onto the ground. The loser moves away and the winner gets the female. All this is based on pheromone signals that are released by the female when the breeding season is in progress. The males have a paired sex organ. It's called the hemipenis. Gestation lasts between 30 to 50 days. Eggs again need either very high humidity or temperatures, depending upon where the species actually lives. And generally they hatch between 60 to 70 days later.